Well, good morning, everyone. Paul Harmon here. I want to welcome you to Hope Chapel this beautiful Sunday. And I say beautiful because this whole weekend in Southern California has been outstanding. I want to just welcome not only you, but would you consider inviting your family if they're there within the home or maybe work colleagues if you gather? I think today's message is very significant. I would encourage you to get something to write with. Naturally, get your Bibles. But before we begin, even before I pray for our service and we get into worship, I just want to highlight a couple of things happening at Hope Chapel. We continue to enjoy our regathering of our community and certainly those who call Hope Chapel their home church. We have this particular day, this Sunday at 2 o'clock, we have our annual reports being displayed. We call it our annual business meeting, but it's 2 o'clock. In the hub. We want to invite you to be a part of that. Would you continue to just investigate all the good things that your church, Hope Chapel, is doing? We display all of our financial records for the year 2020. So come on out. We want to brag on what God has done through you and thank you for your generosity. Also, we have our life groups. They are 6-week Bible fellowships. They begin this 23rd of January. You can sign up online. If you would just go ahead, you can find that right there on our website, hopechapelhb.org. Just go right there. You'll see the little slider describes it. Click on that, and you can sign up online. We would welcome that. You would enjoy that. We encourage that. And then finally, February 7th, we're taking an opportunity to make our new members' celebration Sunday happen. Those who have just been describing all the great things that God's doing through the ministry of Hope Chapel, through the collective efforts of the Christians here and those in the community, we want to just welcome you to say, boy, it's strength to you to say, I want to be a part of what God is doing there and become an abiding member of Hope Chapel. So we want to encourage you, just consider that as well. But in the meantime, let's get busy. Thank you for listening to those brief messages about what's happening here at Hope Chapel. Let's just jump on in, be a part of everything that you can, but especially right now. Let's pray. Father, thank you. Thank you for Jesus, and thank you for the peace that passes all understanding, and that, Lord, for your presence to come right into our home, our dwelling places, and to us, for all of us, to experience you, Almighty God, in a fresh and flowing, life-giving way. For your glory now, in Jesus' name, amen. Let's worship the Lord together.
Thank you. is the glory forever. Amen. Sing on earth. On earth as it is, in heaven, let heaven come to earth as it is, in heaven, let heaven. I can feel heaven in this room. I can feel heaven in this room, all around me.
Lord, we just love to worship you, God. We just love to love you, Lord. We just want our praise to be heard by you. We just want our love to pour out for you, God. We just want you to know how much we love you, how much we cherish every single moment we have with you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, living in our lives, for living with us, walking with us by our side, every step of the way in life. Thank you, God. Thank you, Jesus.
And how great the chasm that lay between us, how high the could not climb, and in desperation I turned to heaven, spoke your name into the night. And then through the darkness your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written, Jesus Christ, my living hope. And who could imagine so great a mercy, what I could fathom, such boundless grace. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah. Christ, my living hope.
Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried body began to break. The silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Came the morning that sealed the promise. Your very body began to break, and out of the silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Jesus, yours is the victory. Oh, hallelujah. Praise the one who set me free. Grip on me, you have broken every chain. There's salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me, you have broken every chain. Salvation in your name, Jesus Christ, my living hope. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Oh, Jesus Christ, my living hope. We thank and just praise you for who your name, for what your name is, Lord God. Just thank you for your love and your mercies that are new every morning, Lord. For you bless the rest of this time that we have. Just bless the message from Pastor Paul. And we just praise this time right now. We just give this time up to you in Jesus' name.
Welcome back, everyone. Paul Harmon here. I want to encourage you, let's get our Bibles in hand. It's time to get into the Word. I think a very timely message. As you and I realize, we are in our new year theme. That theme is Already Won in 2021. That's our theme here at Hope Chapel. We're taking a look at really the way God has allowed us to experience breakthrough, and especially in this time in our nation. We're so thrilled how you continue to put your confidence in Almighty God, allowing His confidence, His peace, to reign supreme in your life personally and for your family. So God's going to do some great works, is He not? We're thrilled about that. Today's message is also equally important. It's our part three of our series, already won, but that's what it is titled, already won, the battle is spiritual. The battle is spiritual. As you know, we've been looking at the series, really, and the theme, it's from Romans chapter 8, verse 37. Let me read that passage to you. It says, yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. More than conquerors, not just conquerors, more than conquerors. We're going to take a look at the reminder about how things really in our life, there's a spiritual battle that's going on. You know, a lot of people downplay the fact of demonic involvement, satanic elements. They really do. And they even make a little bit of a joke of it. Heard a cute little story about a husband who went shopping with his wife, and he told her, honey, no more clothing. Do not buy any more clothing or dresses. Well, the woman went off and saw this dress in the window, desired to put it on, and as she put it on, she really liked it and bought it secretly. Some days later, the husband discovered it. He was so upset, and she says, honey, I really liked the dress after I put it on, and Satan tempted me to buy it. And he said, why didn't you do what the Bible said to do, and that is to get behind me, Satan. She said, you know, I did. And the devil said, the dress looks great even from a distance. Ah, it's interesting how we can just play things off always as the enemy would want us to and say, it's not my fault. But listen, we want to take a look at the importance, the reality. We are in a spiritual battle. Our nation needs Christians to rise up and to be alert. Matter of fact, denial of reality is really dangerous. So let's pray right now. Heavenly Father, thank you for opening the Word to us. Thank you for allowing us to see some things that are going to bring a breakthrough. Matter of fact, I even just as I'm praying, Lord, I'm asking for peace over people who are fearful or are afraid. Lord, thank you. You're going to do a great thing right now in Jesus' name. Hey, I want to just even start off. It's interesting that was quickened to me. Can you imagine how much peace is in Almighty God's being, how much peace he has? Scripture says that the devil, Satan, there is no peace. Matter of fact, Isaiah 48, verse 22 says that the wicked have no peace, says the Lord. There is no peace with the wicked, but there is with the people of God. So I just want to say, be at peace. But let's take a look at this topic. The battle is spiritual. To be in denial of that reality is very, very dangerous. The example would be really the Titanic. They had this thought that the Titanic was unsinkable, and that played into a lot of the decisions of that ship. Like, for example, not having enough lifeboats for the passengers. They even overlooked the warnings of the icebergs in the North Atlantic. When news finally came to the White Star Line ship company that the Titanic was in trouble, that the vice president, his name was Franklin, even downplayed it, saying that we have complete confidence in the Titanic. We believe that boat is unsinkable. When that news came to the vice president of the Star Line, that basically at that very moment that the Titanic was at the bottom of the ocean. We can see that for Christians to deny the reality of a spiritual battle really is detrimental, could actually even be deadly. It's important for us once again to recognize these things because we want to stand firm because we've been noticing and seeing things in our present day culture and around the world. Things are heating up. And we know this to be true. As Jesus says that the devil will kick it up a notch knowing that his time is short. So let's look at these things. We want you to be aware of that because our arsenal not only is peace, but certainly in the reality that we have victory in Jesus. Jesus Christ paid for our sins, and with that, we're right with God. So peace to you, my friends. Matter of fact, I love the words of Jesus in John 14, 27. Just go ahead and write that down. He just says, peace I leave with you, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives do I give to you. Let not your heart be troubled, neither let it be afraid. So let's continue on. Jesus came to destroy the works of the devil. Let's look here for a moment, if you would. 1 John chapter 3, verse 8. You can see it right there. It says, "He who sins is of the devil, for the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil." And he has done that. Calvary's cross and the resurrection defeated death, the grave, and demonic activity. But they're still active. They're still doing an undermining work of God's will in his kingdom. So let's take a look at some principles. We know this. It's already won in Jesus. Let's remember that. But number one point, we must acknowledge we have a spiritual enemy. That's important. It's crystal clear in Scripture there is a spiritual enemy. It does us no good to deny it. It does us no good to say, "I don't want to address that subject." That does not help at all. It's important for us. Let's look here at 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8 and 9. "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, walks about like a roaring lion, seeking whom he may devour. Resist him steadfast in the faith, knowing that the same sufferings are experienced by your brotherhood in the world." Now, it's important here. Isn't it interesting? Peter's writing under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, and the conflict, the suffering around the world, he's saying, is attributed to the devil. That's important to recognize that, to see that. No, not all suffering. But I'll tell you, much of the suffering is attributed to the works of demonic activity. So when we take a look at that, I do like the fact, too, since you're in 1 Peter, you may want to turn to chapter 4. In 1 Peter chapter 4, he even says, "Don't think it's a strange thing about the fiery trials that are coming your way." Look at just for a moment here, 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. "Beloved, do not think it's strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened to you. But rejoice to the extent that you are partaking of Christ's sufferings, and that when his glory is revealed, you may be also," or "may also be glad with exceeding joy." Now, it's interesting. He's saying, don't think it's a strange thing that this is happening to you. Why? Only people that don't recognize it's a spiritual battle is going to think, this is strange. Why am I having these things happen to me? Hey, if a person is in combat, if they're in battle, they're not going to think it's a strange thing that bullets are whizzing past them. That's not a strange thing to be in battle. You are in a spiritual battle. Don't think it's a strange thing when things start moving and going bump in the middle of the night and things start to cause a suffering. Take word, be careful, because Satan influences and controls people around the globe. He's got an evil agenda. Got to remember here, when we talk the battle is spiritual, God has an agenda and Satan has an agenda. Let's remember that. That's important for us. So we are either going to advance one agenda or the other. We are basically going to be a part of one or the other agenda. We're going to promote one agenda or the other agenda. Can you hear that from me? And you might say, well, listen, I'm not for either, really. I'm just kind of like doing my own thing. Well, that's even detrimental, and I'm going to explain that in a little bit, because that could really cause havoc and currently is, even to the people of God that don't walk in obedience with him. But let's take a look at another scripture that highlights it really is a spiritual battle. I'm in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 through 12. You find that there with me? I'm in the New Living Translation this time. I'd like to read it because I think it kind of highlights a little more in a plain wording for us. And finally, it says, a final word, "Be strong in the Lord and in the power and in his power, his mighty power. Put on all of God's armor so that you will be able to stand firm against all strategies of the devil. For we are not fighting against flesh and blood enemies, but against evil rulers and authorities of the unseen world, against mighty powers in this dark world, and against evil spirits in the heavenly places." Wow, take a look at that for a moment. What Scripture is telling us is to look past the people you see. They are not the ones you are wrestling with. I wrestled in high school. It's a contact sport. It is you against the opposition. No help, no tag team, nobody coming in on the mat saying, hey, let's rescue. But we are to be strong in the Lord and the power of His might. God provides what He is. It's already won in Him. But our point being is that Satan and his demons use people like pawns. We want to be careful about that. I've even seen Christians thinking they're well-meaning Christians do very destructive things. They are influenced, maybe even controlled by demonic activity. They kind of forgot there is a spiritual battle, and they bring division and divisiveness and destructive patterns. Oh, Satan hates unity. That's why he attacks it in Christian circles viciously, why he tries to destroy the homes viciously, because we're very strong together as Christians in Christ. Please remember that. Please remember. It's so important. I remember my first years as a little upstart pastor in Banning, California. Oh, man, the little group of 12 of us, we had so much problem with some of the old guard there, and they thought they were doing well, but it was so disruptive. I speak a lot about that in our basically Gifts of the Spirit class and how to operate that in the gift of discerning of spirits. It's interesting to note, but let's take a look here at our material. It's important. Number two, we must understand our enemy's strategies. That's important when we look here. Letter A, Satan doesn't want you to worship him. He wants you to act like him. Now let's look here for a moment, because a lot of people think, well, devil just wants us to worship him and not worship God. That's not true. That's not his intent. He wants you to act like him. Let's look for a moment here. I want you to take a look at Romans chapter 1, verse 25. Let's see here. It says, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie. See that word? The lie. And worshiped and served the creature or even creation rather than the Creator, who is blessed forever. Amen. So when we look here for a moment, people think, well, hey, I'm not out there worshiping the devil. He's not influencing me. I'm not about going to follow the devil. What are you talking about? Well, his intention is for you to not follow God either. That's important. If he can get you to follow the creature, the creation, if he can have you follow not the Creator God, but the creature, you or somebody else, what that is, hey, how I see things, what I want, my own thing. We're literally rejecting God. I'm going with my feelings. I'm going with what I feel I want to see. How I feel needs to be said or done. What we're doing is we are rejecting God. We're literally worshiping ourselves. You can see where the devil is so smooth and stealthy. Well, you don't have to follow me. Just don't follow God. Why don't you go after your own thing? Live a life that's independently away from God's authority, away from God's word. Watch out. That is what he's wanting you to do. Be careful. And that is a lie. That is the lie. So when chapter 1 of Romans says, who exchanged the truth of God for the lie, that's it. I don't need God. I'm just going to do my own thing. I'm not going to follow Satan or God. And what we end up doing is rebelling against God. And that's all Satan wants. That's why we talk about being obedient to the Lord, not acting like the devil who says, I resist and I refuse anything that God has to say to me. Let's take a look at letter B. Satan controls people with lies. In John chapter 8, verse 44, it's the New Living Translation once again. It says, for you are the children of your father, the devil, and you love to do the evil things he does. He was a murderer from the beginning. He has always hated the truth because there is no truth in him. When he lies, it is consistent with his character, for he is a liar and the father of lies. So Satan uses people he has deceived to deceive others. So we're taking a look. The battle is spiritual. They say the devil comes on in, deceives people, and those same people go about promoting that narrative, that lie. That's what's happening. Yeah, I think it's worth noting because that's the way the Apostle Paul described it in 2 Corinthians chapter 11. Let's look there, 2 Corinthians 11, verse 14 through 15, New Living Translation. "But I am not surprised," he says, "even Satan disguises himself as an angel of light, so it is no wonder that his servants also disguise themselves as servants of righteousness." You can imagine these people who are deceived, they don't understand. They actually think they are promoting something that's just right. They are actually promoting a lie. Can you see how that works? They are actually not doing what's right, but they think they're doing what is right. And it's tough to have a rational conversation with people like that. Have you found that to be the case? People that buy into a lie, because the battle is spiritual, remember, and you have to recognize that it's the kingdom of God versus the kingdom of Satan. It's light versus darkness. It's truth versus error. It really is that clear. It's spiritual versus flesh. So it's important for us once again. And I really have been so encouraged when I see something like 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 14 and 15. Let me bring that up there. It's also a New Living Translation. But if you're ever in a conversation with somebody that's bought into a lie from darkness, it has nothing to do with truth. It's tough because the Scripture says, "But people who aren't spiritual can't receive these truths from God's Spirit. It all sounds foolish to them, and they can't understand it. For all those who are spiritual can understand what the Spirit means, and those who are spiritual can evaluate all things." So once again, it's important for us. Satan controls people by lies. That's why Ephesians chapter 6, remember we read that, that it's not flesh or blood that we're battling. We really are to look beyond that person. There is a battle in the spiritual realm. So when you and I get upset with our political leaders, our national leaders, our local elected official, mayor, governors, those things that we've taken a look at, and the decisions that they make, we just scratch our head and say, oh, we really do need to pray for them, do we not? We really need to look beyond. We need to look beyond the person and realize there are influencing elements, probably of darkness. So it's important for us. That's why I like 1 Thessalonians 5:21. You may want to write that down. It literally just says, man, test all things and hold on to those things that are true. Remember, the battle is spiritual. You find that you're battling something, nobody you see in your home, nobody you see in your work is your enemy. Nobody you see in of our elected official is our enemy. There are controlling powers of darkness. You remember back in the garden, the original author of fake news really is Satan himself. He was the one that painted a narrative to Eve and Adam. Hey, if you just go ahead and disobey God, God's really holding out on you. And if you take hold of that particular fruit from that particular tree, you're going to be like God. So basically, why don't you disobey, disrespect God, do your own thing. So that false narrative continues to be promoted. And it's important for us. It's why we want to get into Bible fellowship. It's why we want to get into discipleship classes. We want to know the Word. Say, you know what? That doesn't sound like the heart of Jesus, what you're telling me, to just separate and divide and destroy this and blackmail that and blaspheme that person. Well, that doesn't sound like the heart of Jesus. Word of God says we are to do things better, and especially in love. You know, bankers, when they wanted to take a look how to detect a bogus money, they would take a look at really real bills, real money, and play with that. It's how they used to do it in banking, to detect counterfeit bills. You deal with the real stuff. I think it's important. Let's deal with the real stuff found in the Scriptures. Letter C, Satan wants geographic control of planet Earth. I really believe that. Scripture's clear of that. Let's look at that. It's helpful when we see the power struggles going around the planet. Even though we just think they're governing or maybe state or even nations and the officials are going at it. Once again, remember, we see in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12. Let me read it. New King James says, "For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places." So it's important for us to recognize this. And there's one passage that really distinctly describes the conflict between the angelic and the demonic. I found that in Daniel chapter 10. In Daniel chapter 10, verse 12 through 13, Daniel is fasting and seeking God for the answers. He knows King Cyrus. If you read Daniel chapter 9, Cyrus is the king. The 70 years is about to culminate. God's promised to bring back the nation of Israel from captivity. Lord, how are you going to do it? What does this vision mean? And as he is praying, an angel visitation comes. That's what we have here in verse 12 of Daniel 10. It says, "Then he said to me, 'Do not fear, Daniel, for from the first day that you set your heart to understand and to humble yourself before your God, your words were heard, and I have come because of your words. But the prince of the kingdom of Persia withstood me 21 days. And behold, Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me, for I had not been felt along or helped along there with the kings of Persia." I had not been in that area. He needed help from Michael, the archangel. You can see the battle going on and the struggle that was helped. And in the area of that, the battle for geographic control of planet Earth. There are entities that are controlling cities, maybe even streets, maybe even actually nations. We see here it's very clear. It's the clearest passage, really. And there's a rage that's happening before the angelic and the demonic. That's important for us. Remember, the battle is spiritual. So would you say, well, Pastor Paul, are there angels and are there demonic entities that are influencing Huntington Beach or downtown Huntington Beach? Absolutely. That's why Hope Chapel is planted where it's planted. That's the joy of having a church. That's why people pray and seek the Lord. Lord, where do you want us to plant a church? Because there is, as the scripture says in 2 Corinthians 5:20, remember, we are ambassadors of Christ. Christians represent the kingdom of God. We represent Christ. It's important for us. When we take a look at churches are placed in specific geographical areas. Why? Because the battle is spiritual. We're not just doing that to try to really please humanity. We want to help humanity, but especially bring God's love and the good news. So we want to look at God's values and realize there are specific things God's wanting to have happen, probably right there where you live, right where you work or where you're studying. Let's take a look at number three. We must learn how to stand firm to win. Let's take a look at these final points here. To stand firm to win, because that's important. Remember, already won in 2021. We're going to claim some territory, you and me, and we're going to believe because of what Jesus has already done on Calvary's cross. But how do we go about doing that so when we are facing opposition, that's important for us? Let's remind ourselves with 1 Peter chapter 5, verse 8. It says here in the New Living Translation, "Stay alert." I like that, don't you? "Stay alert. Watch out for your great enemy, the devil. He prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." We are to intentionally be watchful. That's really what it's saying. Intentionally, be alert. Don't always just think it's going to be pleasant. There is a devil out there waiting to take advantage of people. And let's make sure that we are alert as well. Be alert to see his lies or his influence or his activities. You can see it's very easy to detect because you love the Lord. You know the things of God's word. Sometimes when you see people who are divisive, you see people who have attitudes, who are just exchanging harsh words, maybe on social media, You and I do not want to be a part of that. Do not get suckered into that. That's a realm that's going off. Remember how that James 1 says that the wrath of man does not work the righteousness of God. So be careful about that. Watch out for that. We want to be alert enough to guard our heart. Don't let everything in your heart. Recognize certain things can be whispered in your thoughts that you just know that's not from the Lord, to just degrade and have suspicion over somebody I know has integrity in their life. Watch out. Proverbs 4, verse 23 says, guard your heart with all diligence, for out of it springs the issues of life. Don't let that stuff in. You can certainly just kind of run it through and say, ah, that's not of the Lord. That's why Jesus said so clearly in Luke chapter 6, verse 45, that really it's out of the depths or out of the issues or the being of our heart, the mouth speaks. It's important for us to be mindful of that. So when we take a look there, we want to recognize the importance of that. We win with spiritual alertness. That's our point. Win with spiritual alertness. Be alert. Be alert. Let's take a look at letter B. Win with spiritual authority. That's a significant one. I like that. We already saw where Ephesians 6:10 says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. But would you notice with me at Luke chapter 10, verse 17 to 20. Luke 10, 17 to 20. Here we have 70 of the followers of Jesus. They return. In Luke chapter 10, verse 1, he sends them out to cities and go and speak that I'm coming, go and heal the sick, just bring in the news that the kingdom of God has come. But this is their report that they came back with. In verse 17, says, then the 70 returned with joy. Why? Saying, Lord, even the demons are subject to us in your name. And Jesus, or he said to them, I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven. Behold, I give you the authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. Take a look at that one phrase, and nothing shall by any means hurt you. If you ever get hurt, you're like, Lord, something's going on here. But we finish off, nevertheless, he says in verse 20, do not rejoice in this that the spirits are subject to you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. And that's an important phrase. I like that. That's why we never really talk much about casting certain things out. I mean, if we have to, we know we're dealing with another entity here, then we'll take authority. But just for a moment, let's rejoice that our names are written in heaven. Hebrews 12, 23 talks about that. Also how Revelation mentions about the book of life in Revelation 20, verse 15. Let's make sure. How do you get your name in that book? By believing that Jesus is the Savior, is the Messiah, and you've asked him to be your personal Lord and Savior as well. Your name get written in the book of life. Rejoice when that happens. Jesus was telling his followers, don't get all stoked over how you have authority over works of darkness. When you need it, it's yours. That's important. How does that work? You can imagine they discovered something here, and that letter B was, we win with spiritual authority. Jesus says, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions. I give you that ability. You have that right. Power is in Jesus, but you, if you need it, you wheel it. And when did they need to wheel it? In your name, in the name of Jesus. Boy, that's so important. If you ever have conflict, if you know that something's not right, you know sometimes you're walking down the street or you're walking into the house or somebody else's house, like, boy, there's tension here. Something's not right. You literally could say, anything that's not of God, I command, get out of here in the name of Jesus. It's amazing how it changes the atmosphere. I've had to do it more ways and more times than I could imagine. Always want to eliminate the static in the air, because the battle is spiritual. To overlook that, to deny that, to ignore that, complicates things and almost could make it a deadly environment. Very disruptive. So when you command an element of an evil entity to be gone in the name of Jesus, that is taking authority. That's the term. Take authority over that. Command it to go. Remember, Jesus says, Behold, I give you authority to trample on serpents and scorpions and over all the power of the enemy. Over all the power of the enemy. Rewrite that verse down. Make sure you acknowledge that. And that's why we stand on faith. So command it to go in the name of Jesus. You don't plead. Once God says, I give you the right, you go make it happen. You don't, oh, Lord, would you please take away this spirit of just anger, division, or lust from me? He might just say, you command that entity to be gone. Go ahead, in the name of Jesus, get out of here and do not come again. So it's important for us, isn't it? Because I love how Scripture says in 1 John 4:4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he who is in you than he who is in the world. Let's remember that, okay? Demonic elements, demonic creatures, they have no authority. They have no authority unless you or I give them that authority, or they go under cover, causing disruption, but they go undetected. We literally have not commanded them, get out of our home, get away from my business, get out of my pocketbook, get away from my marriage and family. That's important for you to remember that. And part of that standing in faith and standing strong is a life of obedience. Can I just add that? It's important for you to know I want to follow God's agenda. And to what I know to do, I am obeying God. That's important for you. Jesus calls us to follow him, what he's doing, when he's doing it, and when exactly that's going to happen and where. It's important to be obedient. Why? It's a cute little story. You may want to write it down and look at a little later in Acts 19, verse 15. Again, Acts 19, 15, there's these seven sons of Sceva, seven brothers. They decided to want to go and practice this commanding in the name of Jesus to get this demon out of this person. And they said, we exorcise you, which means we command you, in Jesus' name, who Paul preaches. And that creature in that dude, if you read it, says, well, hey, Jesus I know and Paul I know, but who are you? And the scripture logs it, says that demon jumped on those seven brothers, stripped them of their clothes, and they ran out of the building naked and wounded. So you really want to be one in Christ and walking in obedience. Finally, let me just say this as we wrap things up. Number C, win with spiritual relationships. Boy, that's so important. When we take a look at spiritual relationships, it's in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25. Not forsaking, Scripture says, the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some, but exhorting one another, and so much more as you see the day approaching. Letter D in day is capitalized. There is going to be an event of the return of Christ. I think it's certain for sure in our own lifetime. I really believe that. But the emphasis is we win because we are in spiritual relationships. Would you consider once again, it's so important, we are stronger together. We are stronger when we are with each other. We're healthier together. We're safer together. I never want to play down the pandemic. People are safe because of health issues to stay home. But we have really bought into a lie for the last 10 months that we're safer at home. Friends, statistically, it's destroying the family to be isolated for such lengthy time. I want to encourage you, would you venture out, even here at Hope Chapel? We are making it as safe as we can with social distancing and mask, temperature checking, but you need community. You need to actually engage. Call our church. Let us know what's going on. Matter of fact, James 5 says, if anybody's sick, let him call for the elders. So if we don't know that something's happening, you're responsible to call. So I want to encourage you. Let's get together once again. We win with spiritual relationships. Get solid Christians around you. Let's believe for that. Well, I want to thank you for joining me. I want to take a moment right now. Matter of fact, I want to just even stand. It's interesting. I just had the oil vials here. We have them in the sanctuary. We often will have altar prayer time, praying for the sick, praying for people that are facing opposition. As I close out today's message and our time together, I want to just even spiritually apply the oil to you, especially if you're feeling that you have such opposition coming your way that you just don't know how to handle that. Let's stand, you and I, in faith. Let's believe for the victory. Our theme, already won. Yet in all these things, Romans 8, 37 says, yet in all these things, what are some of those things you're facing? Yet in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. That's Jesus. He loves you so much. Let's first just take a moment now. And if you don't have Christ as your Savior, would you just pray with me a short, simple prayer? It goes like this, dear Jesus, I surrender my life to you. I want to live my life according to your plans, according to your will. Wash me clean of my sin. Come into my life to stay. Help me, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I'm going to take a moment right now. If you prayed that prayer, would you go on our website? Would you send us a little post-it note? Would you even email us? We'd love to hear from you, office@hopechapelhb.org. Just let us know that you prayed to receive Christ. I would encourage you, as I dip my finger in the oil, I'm going to spiritually apply it. If you have something physically hurting in your body, would you just put your own hand on that? If you have tension in your home, things are collapsing, there's a breakdown of unity and peace in your home, then let's believe that those elements, the battle is spiritual. Remember, look beyond people. Then let's claim victory right now. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you that it's in the name of Jesus we pray. And Father, Son, Holy Spirit, that Lord, you do a tremendous work of victory. We come against sickness, command it to be gone in the name of Jesus. Despair and opposition, breakdown of relationships, get out. Anything that's causing lies and division, hostility, hatred, be removed in Jesus' name. Lord, we speak your peace, your kingdom come, your will to be done. It's your word that says in Romans 14, 17, that the kingdom of God is righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. So, Lord, we thank you. Sickness be gone in Jesus' name. Financial provision come, come. Opportunity for work be restored, and healthy, vibrant relationships and an abundance of joy just permeate. Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, I want to thank you once again. What a joy it is for me and an honor for me to bring the scriptures so that you and I can enjoy this. Thank you for praying for our nation. Our nation needs your prayers. Thank you for praying for Paul and Ainsley Harmon. We thank you for your prayers. We love what we are doing for God, but especially for you. We love Hope Chapel, and we love you. We look forward to better times when we can be together in those common grounds. But in the meantime, God bless you, keep you. God cause his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May God's countenance come upon you and give you peace. God bless you. Thank you. I want to thank you for joining us today at Hope Chapel, Huntington Beach. It's our desire to bring the teachings of this church to others globally. If today's message has brought you closer to Jesus, we want to know. Can you send us an email to office@hopechapelhb.org? Would you consider supporting this ministry financially? You can give securely online at hopechapelhb.org/give. If a check is your preferred method, you can send a mailed check to Hope Chapel, P.O. Box 548, Huntington Beach, California, 92648. If you want to be contacted by Hope Chapel, would you consider subscribing to our weekly newsletters at hopechapelhb.org/subscribe? Whatever season of life you're in, we want to go through it with you. We want to thank you once again for joining us, and God bless you.